sporting hero now credited with a place in social history. BBC Two discusses the reputation of boxer Joe Lewis.
This is Arlington Cemetery, on the outskirts of Washington, D.C., the traditional resting place of America's war heroes. Sergeant Joe Lewis's reputation was built on his record as the greatest heavyweight champion in the history of boxing. He never saw actual combat. But to his fellow Americans, Lewis's achievements in the ring came to symbolize the fighting strength of the whole country.
Boxing is war individualized, a contest pitting man against man that is so elemental that it strips humans down to their barest essentials. Size matters. Therefore, the heavyweight champion comes to represent the sort of best, the biggest, the baddest man in his nation.
And what mattered to America in 1938 was the outcome of Lewis's fight with the darling of Nazi Germany, Max Schmeling.
It was not about two people fighting for the heavyweight championship of the world. It was about two societies, two philosophies.
It was good versus evil. It was Hitler versus us. And something happened that afternoon that changed the role of Joe Lewis in American history, bang, just like that.
In an era of prejudice and segregation, Lewis was uniquely popular. White Americans called him a credit to his race. Black Americans were inspired to follow in his footsteps. But as Lewis would discover, there was an unexpected price to pay for being the torchbearer. He was born Joe Lewis Barrow in Lafayette, Alabama, on the 13th of May, 1914, the youngest but one in a family of eight children. Like thousands of other blacks in the Cotton Belt, Lewis's family were sharecroppers, the poorest kind of tenant farmers. Throughout the 1920s, more and more gave up the struggle to scrape a living in the rural South and joined the mass migration to the industrial North. The Barrows headed for America's Motor City, Detroit. This is all that remains of what was once called Paradise Valley. Through the boom years of the 20s and the Depression era of the 30s, this was the heart of Detroit's black community. As a teenager, Joe Lewis carried ice and delivered coal in these streets. He found his way out of them via the local boxing club.
I think I really started to become a fighter from when I was going to school. One day I went to the gymnasium. And I started boxing with another boy who was about my size, and I hit him. He went down. For some reason or another, I liked it. My mother wanted me to be a violin player. But after I had my first taste of that knockout, I guess, in school, I wanted to become a fighter. So I had a lot. Well, because I couldn't think of my big hand being put on the violin anyway.
At that time, boxing was a way out for kids at that time because this was the Depression. See, everybody was poor at that time. And Joe was as poor as anybody you ever seen. He was poor.
In his first year as a fighter, Lewis won the Golden Gloves, the greatest prize in American amateur boxing. The following year, he turned professional. His managers were two small-time racketeers, Julian Black and John Roxburgh.
I'm satisfied you're going to be the next heavyweight champion of the world.
I hope so.
Well, Joe, as your manager, I'm going to do everything possible to get you a chance to fight for the championship.
Thank you.
But there was a problem. In the 1930s, the words "whites only," which adorned everything from dining cars to drinking fountains, also applied to every professional sport in America.
There's a real question whether my father would ever get a chance to fight for the heavyweight championship of the world. His first and really his only trainer, Jack Blackburn, really didn't want to train him, really didn't want to spend any time with him, because he didn't think he'd ever get a shot for the title, because he's black.
Boxing's color bar had been broken only once before, in 1908, when Jack Johnson became the first ever black heavyweight champion. But white America found Johnson offensive. He was loud and arrogant, and even dared to have affairs with white women.
There was almost a conspiracy not to let another black near the championship. It was the white man's championship. They could win other divisions. They weren't the heavyweight champions. The heavyweight champion was a white province.
Before he could even be considered as a contender, Lewis would have to win over white America.
Joe Lewis is one of the friendliest fellows you'd ever want to meet. Outside the ring, of course. He's a regular guy.
His managers took the unprecedented step of publicly announcing a code of conduct for their fighter, designed to distance Lewis from the memory of Jack Johnson. Johnson had grinned and gloated. Lewis was to keep deadpan in front of the cameras and was never to brag. He was to fight clean and live clean, and he was never to have his picture taken with a white woman.
Whatever Jack Johnson did, Joe did the direct opposite in terms of his appearance with females. Jack was a prodigious drinker. He was a taunter. Joe did none of those things.
So white America says, well, some of white America, not all of white America, but some of white America says, well, we'll accept this guy because if he's going to be a champion, then at least he's not threatening us. He's not making us feel we might feel inferior. He's not doing anything to throw out of balance where the white man stands in this country and where the black man stands in this country.
But it was an uneasy accommodation. Boxing writers in particular delighted in devising nicknames for the new black prospect. And in 1935, when Lewis took his first step towards the title in a fight with the Italian Primo Carnera, politics was thrown into the mix as well.
Carnera was a very important fight for me because of my first fight in New York. It meant that if I got over Carnera, that I would be on my way to bigger things.
Primo Carnera was the ex-heavyweight champion. It was Lewis's first fight in New York, so he was on center stage for boxing. But boxing only was a stage for other things happening in the world then. Italy was a totalitarian government. Carnera was seen as the representative of the Mussolini government.
With Mussolini poised to invade Ethiopia, a boxing match between a black man and an Italian suddenly had greater significance. By the night of the fight itself, racial and political tensions had created such an ugly mood that the ring announcer felt obliged to remind the crowd that what they were about to witness was, first and foremost, a sporting contest.
Regardless of race, creed or color, may the better men emerge victorious.
Lewis was the better man. The victory over Carnera confirmed him as a real prospect for the heavyweight title. He was still only 21. Fight fans like a winner, and soon Lewis's sparring sessions were spectator events. Today, a marble memorial stands on the site of his old training camp in Pompton Lakes, a small town just outside New York.
When Joe Lewis came to Pompton Lakes in the 30s, he brought with him a vibrance, an excitement. People knew he was coming because he was kind of a person that became one with Pompton Lakes. The local businessman, he was involved in an accident where he was struck by a vehicle, and unfortunately he died. And he died because at that time Pompton Lakes didn't have an ambulance service. Joe Lewis heard about this, bought an exhibition bout and donated the proceeds of that bout, and they were able to buy their first 1935 Packard ambulance. Joe Lewis wanted to buy a house in Pompton Lakes, and there was one under construction here on this particular street on Lincoln Avenue. But for some reason, the builder didn't want to sell it to Joe. They were afraid, perhaps, that there would be too many blacks in those days moving into Pompton Lakes. They welcomed him with open arms as a visitor to Pompton Lakes, and he has a lot of positive things, but I still think underneath it all, they still felt black was black and white was white.
Lewis may not yet have won over white America, but to black Americans, he was an idol.
Now in this land, there is a new sensation.
When Joe Lewis went a fight, everybody would get out, ride up and down this like it was a holiday. And I mean, blowing their horns and doing different things, but places would stay home all night long. You couldn't imagine how it was.
Black entertainers rushed to record musical tributes. And when Lewis went with his new wife, Marva, to Harlem, they were mobbed.
Who's the credit to his grace? Ain't the trunk with a poker face. Joy Pulloy, no jive to McCoy. That's Joe the Bomber.
He was their hope. He was their dream. He was their equalizer. He was the only person who could legitimately beat up on a white man and get away with it. He was the only black man that was portrayed in newspaper articles other than crimes. He was a black man that symbolized, if you allow us to play on equal grounds, we can compete and we can win.
By the summer of 1936, Lewis needed just one more victory to earn a title fight with heavyweight champion Jim Braddock. The only other contender was a German boxer, Max Schmeling.
The first Lewis Schmeling fight in 1936 was viewed as an important fight only in that it was another ex-champion that Lewis could beat up on in his march to the championship. And here comes Max Schmeling, former champion. Basically, over-the-hill former champion. So he's brought over to the States as cannon fodder. That's all he is.
Schmeling, on arriving in this country, he was very cute about it. The reporters asked him if he thought he really had a chance. Schmeling, with a twinkle, said, yes, I see something. I see something. But he didn't say what.
From watching Joe Lewis in pictures and in action, have you discovered any particular weakness in the Brown Bomber?
Yes, I did. But I won't tell.
What Schmeling had seen was Lewis's habit of dropping his left hand after throwing a punch. With his guard down, Lewis was leaving himself open to a knockout punch from his opponent.
After he knocked me down the second round, after that I didn't know nothing. I think I went about 12 rounds without I didn't know nothing about where I was. The only thing I remember after the fight was that when I getting out of the ring, I remember it sounded like my sister hollering, "Cover his face up, cover his face up."
When he lost to Max Schmeling, my mother said he was devastated. He felt that he let everyone down because he shouldn't have lost 1936. He actually started reading the press. He started getting more cocky. He started believing the press that he was invincible. How could he lose to Max Schmeling? He was 8 years younger. He was much stronger. He was the Brown Bomber. And I think that was the most important lesson to my father.
The rapturous celebrations that had once greeted a Lewis victory were more than matched by the response in Germany to Schmeling's surprise win. For the Nazis, this was a great propaganda opportunity.
Goebbels and Hitler had a field day that, I mean, this was proof positive that this was the master race. They didn't need anything more to prove it, and in a sense, use it as a way of trying to frighten other nations into submission. It was a major political tool.
Schmeling's victory also meant that he, and not Lewis, was now next in line to fight for the heavyweight championship of the world.
One of the fears was that Schmeling would win the title from James J. Braddock, take the belt home to Nazi Germany, and nobody would see it again. By now, the heavyweight championship, its meaning was transcending pure supremacy in the ring. Its meaning was really that of a world beater.
The hidden hand behind Lewis's rise through the heavyweight rankings had been his promoter, Mike Jacobs. Jacobs seized on the growing fear of the Nazis to set up a match between Lewis and Braddock, which would ensure that the title remained in the United States. Schmeling had been sidestepped, and the heavyweight championship was once again within Lewis's grasp.
There was pride all over Black America, everywhere Blacks were. People were pouring out on the streets, screaming and hollering and banging pots and pans because their hero was the champion, the most powerful individual in the world, the strongest individual in the world. A Black man was once again the heavyweight champion of the world.
Lewis had the championship. Now he wanted revenge. The rematch with Max Schmeling would take place on June the 22nd, 1938, 2 years almost to the day after the first fight.
The second Schmeling-Lewis fight was much bigger than the first. Everybody recognized what Schmeling represented. Everybody recognized what was at stake.
And that President Roosevelt, he felt my muscles and said that, well, these is the kind of muscles we're gonna need to beat Germany with.
There was a lot of symbolism in this fight. The irony was, here's Joe Lewis representing freedom and democracy for the world, but yet couldn't experience and live those freedoms and all of those opportunities within his own country. It didn't matter to him. What mattered to him was really defeating Max Schmeling. I remember specifically talking with my father about the Schmeling fight, and he would have never felt like he was the heavyweight champion of the world had he not had an opportunity to have a rematch with Max.
In the showdown between freedom and fascism, Schmeling was similarly miscast. He was never a Nazi, and had even been criticized at home for having a Jewish manager.
The only thing I thought, it wasn't fair to bring in sport race questions, you know. Between Joe and I, never had race questions, you know, because He's a sportsman, I'm a sportsman, we're a good sport, and I think there will be never a race question between sportsmen.
The build-up and intensity of that fight was as unlike anything that I've ever seen. The very idea that one fighter who had conquered Joe Louis would come back, representing, in a sense, the Nazi powers, it created an excitement unlike anything. I mean, there were people who had never seen or heard of a boxing match who wanted to know what was going to happen, were involved in that fight, and were listening in all over the country.
First, we had every Afro-American who looked at Schmeling not necessarily as a German, but as a white man, and this was a chance, you know, our guy is going to win. Then you had the Jews who were very conscious of what was happening in Europe, probably more so than anybody else. They were very, very pro Louis because of Schmeling, not because of Louis. Then you had a group called the German-American Bund, a man named Fritz Kuhn, who was going to be the Galateer when Hitler took over the United States. They were violent about Louis, hated him. This country didn't miss fascism by much, and I know because I was there.
70,000 people were packed into Yankee Stadium. Millions more were gathered around their radios. Schmeling needed a police escort to get to the ring. As he made his way through the crowd, he was pelted with banana peel and paper cups.
The famous Detroit Brown Bomber, world's heavyweight champion, Joe Louis.
Joe Louis never personally told me about that night, but Freddie Gignard, who grew up with him in Detroit and was always there and was in that corner, told me that Louis was quieter than he had ever seen him before the fight. And when they got to the corner, he said, "Freddie, you're going to remember what happens tonight." And the bell rang. And of course, he tore him apart. He beat Schmeling so badly that Freddie in the corner could hear Schmeling cry. I mean, he could hear these wails of anguish coming out of him.
It was all over in 2 minutes and 4 seconds. It was a long time in coming, but now I felt like the real champion. I know now this was the top of my career. I had the championship. And I had beaten the man who had humiliated me. My people were proud of me. America was proud of me.
Louis's win over Schmeling was huge. It was a politically powerful propaganda victory. This was what Hitler would have used to his advantage. And it no longer belonged to him. It belonged to the democratic world.
I think that the war clouds on the horizon led many white Americans to begin to see Joe Louis as a national hero. This does not mean that they were entirely comfortable with him defeating a white man, but they were beginning to get comfortable with him as an American.
Over the next 3 years, Louis defended his title an astonishing 17 times. He seemed unstoppable. But once again, events outside the ring were to change the direction of his career. In December 1941, the war that had engulfed Europe finally reached American soil. Louis's response was swift and emphatic.
Joe Louis answers Uncle Sam's call to arms.
What's your occupation?
Fighter, and let's get at them jabs.
The important thing to remember about Joe Louis is he loved this country. He was a patriot. Oftentimes, white Americans didn't think that black Americans loved the country as much as they did. When Joe Louis volunteered for the Army, he said to America, "I am an American too. I was born in this country. I have an obligation to support this country's efforts in the war. And many people were surprised.
There was, at the time, a phenomenal debate going on in black society as to whether or not blacks should even fight in World War II, given the circumstances of black people in this country.
I'm only doing what any red-blood American would do.
So his joining the military had a phenomenal impact.
And we will win because we are on God's side. Thank you.
And the American military was quick to capitalize on the public relations opportunities of having the heavyweight champion in its ranks. Lewis's face was printed on recruitment posters. His off-the-cuff remark was adopted as one of the slogans of the war. And his victory over Max Schmeling became a clarion call to the whole nation.
An American fist won a victory. But it wasn't the final victory.
Especially black Americans.
Now those two men that were matched in the ring that night are matched again. This time in a far greater arena and for much greater stakes.
Joe Lewis in The Negro Soldier becomes the epitome of what every black soldier can be by enlisting, with the overall message being all of you, for all practical purposes, are Joe Lewis, battling Nazi fascism.
It was a persuasive message, but it disguised a harsh reality.
In those days, all blacks going in the army were sent to black units. The black units were sent, for the most part, to the South for training. In the South, they had an apartheid that was more rigid than that in South Africa. Everybody with one drop of black blood was separate drinking fountains, separate provisions in camp. It was a horrible situation to put troops in, and particularly boys from the North who were not accustomed to that type of rigid segregation.
But a unique combination of his celebrity status and a friend, Truman Gibson, in the War Department, meant that for the first time, Lewis was able to take action that was more than just symbolic.
He went to Fort Bragg, North Carolina, for example, one of the biggest of the Army training areas. He called, as he always, wherever he was, every day he called, and he said, well, we have absolute segregation on the buses. So I went into the Undersecretary, Robert Patterson, with whom I worked most closely, who said this couldn't happen. Whereupon they issued an order eliminating all segregation and discrimination on Army post camps and stations. It's one of the things that Joe did. Then when Joe went with his group to England, he found whole towns off limits to black troops. So he made a call. He busted three generals and sent them back to the United States quietly. Joe did a lot of things for which has never been publicly credited. But he had strong beliefs.
By the end of the war, Lewis had spent 3 years on boxing tours designed to boost troop morale. On his return home, he was presented with the Legion of Merit, the highest award a non-combatant can receive.
When Joe arrived in New York on the eventful day, he was received by a multitude of cheering fans with a parade and everything.
Joe Lewis was an inspiration to all the black people because we didn't have nobody at that time to look forward to. And by him, when he coming along, he opened the doors to a lot of things that, and a lot of feelings that we never had before. We couldn't play baseball, we couldn't play basketball, we couldn't play hockey, we couldn't play none of those sports. People can't relate. Look at basketball. Basketball now is supposed to be a black sport. Basketball years ago was a white sport. Black people couldn't play it. So, I mean, it was an inspiration.
Military service had made Lewis Black America's most effective ambassador. Leading by example, he played a vital role in removing racial segregation from sport in post-war America. newspaper columnist Jimmy Cannon composed what has since become the most widely quoted tribute ever uttered in praise of Joe Louis. "He is," wrote Cannon, "a credit to his race, the human race." In the climate of the times, this was high praise indeed.
Magic lover, tell your secret charm.
But there was another side to Louis, one which belied his public image.
Enchanting arm, let me feel that mystic spell.
He was quite the debonair man at that time, you know. And he liked to go around the showgirls, and the girls all loved him. And he loved the girls, you know. He was a man. He loved being around all the young girls. They clamored around him, and he liked to entertain them.
The man was a total hedonist. Well, why not? In that era, in that time, the heavyweight champion can do anything he wants to do. Writers will not write about it. There was no television. And certainly the weekly newsreels is the last thing they wanted for family entertainment. So when Joe was sleeping with Sonya Henie, the great ice skater, so Joe was sleeping with Sonya Henie. As long as she took her ice skates off, who got hurt? Whatever Joe did, it was okay.
The first casualty was Louis's marriage.
The baby is mighty proud of her daddy, and aren't we all?
Barb was a very, very beautiful woman, very vivacious, was charming, and but Joe was not a model of constancy. Had numerous affairs, the most prominent of them being Lena Horne, but he had several. So Marva just got fed up and said that was it.
Inside the ring, Louis was clearly no longer the same man. Title fights that had once been almost routine were becoming harder and harder. In 1949, he stood down as champion after a difficult final defense against Jersey Joe Walcott.
Joe Louis, longest reigning monarch in heavyweight boxing history. Joe Louis, the fighter with an atom bomb in each fist, retires just shy of his 35th birthday.
I've been champion of the world for 11 years and 3 days. I've defended my championship 25 times. I think I've been told to retire now.
What are you going to do in the future, Joe?
Well, I'm doing the future now, relax and play a lot of golf.
But no sooner had he stepped out of the ring than the money problems began. An alarming tax debt came to light, dating back to two benefit fights staged in 1942.
The financial difficulties for Joe Louis really started when he was in the Army. It started when he donated two purses, one to the Navy and the Army Relief Fund, and they wrote the checks to Joe Louis. And he immediately signed the checks to the Navy and the Army Relief Fund. But because they were made payable to Joe Louis, they wanted him to pay taxes on it. Could the IRS have made an exception? Yes. Could they have interpreted it differently? Yes. He never questioned it. And the fact that he came out of retirement to fight Ezra Charles is because Joe Louis wanted to pay his debt. And the only way he could do so was coming out of retirement and getting in the ring.
But he was in no condition to fight the younger, faster Ezra Charles. That bloody defeat was only a foretaste of what was to come when in October 1951, Louis took on a promising young heavyweight called Rocky Marciano.
I personally was very sorry when he came back to fight Marciano because if you look at the film even, you can see that this is really an imposter. It's not Joe Louis, this is somebody that's called Joe Louis and looks a little bit like Joe Louis's older, fatter uncle or something like that. But no, I didn't think he could win it.
Joe Louis, balding and bulky, eagerly answers the bell. The big question tonight, can the ex-champion come back?
The Louis Marciano fight was one of the saddest days I've ever experienced. Joe Louis was fighting because he was in debt. There was no other reason. 37 years old, he's way over the hill, he's balding, he's fat, he's out of shape.
Being 10 years younger than Joe Louis didn't bother me. What bothered me was the name Joe Louis. He had been a great champion for a long time, ever since I was a young boy, and I had gotten to like and admire the man very much.
And I remember Louis controlled the first couple of rounds with his jab, and he could see openings, but by the time he got to him with his punches, they weren't openings anymore. And inexorably, he was ground down. And then finally knocked through the ropes in one of the saddest scenes I've ever seen, with a newspaper man cradling his head as he fell through the ropes.
I won that fight with mixed feelings. I went over to help Joe get up from the knockdown and just tried actually to say something kind to Joe Louis. I was happy to have won the fight, but I must say, as I looked at Joe Louis, I felt very, very bad.
I did know Rocky Marciano pretty well, and he told me that it just really broke him up to have to knock out Joe Louis. He didn't want to knock him out. When he saw him there, lying there, he said he cried. He cried.
Time had caught up with Louis in the ring. But as far as his tax bill was concerned, the meter was still running. He began to look for other ways to clear his massive debts.
Yes, High Finance, the show that makes dreams come true. It's the former heavyweight champion of the world and his wife, whose dream is to pay off a debt to Uncle Sam. From Chicago, Illinois, Mr. and Mrs. Joe Louis.
Champ, when we talked last week, I said...
1956. I'm married again. And I'm broke. The papers and magazines had all kinds of articles about my tax problems.
We said last week that Mr. Joe Louis, I don't know whether you missed it or not, said that he owed the government over $1 million in back taxes.
Fans were sending me money in the mail. It was times like this I almost cried.
46.
Perfect, all right with those.
That's a good sport, isn't it?
Oh, cool.
You feel the same way?
I really do.
So when a promoter came along with $100,000 for me to wrestle, I didn't think twice about it. Rose was real upset.
Well, everybody's heard about the bird. The bird, bird, bird. The bird's a winner. Well, the bird, bird, bird. The bird is a winner. Well, the bird, bird, bird. Well, the bird is a winner.
When he told me that he was going to wrestle, I said, you can't wrestle. I said, that's just like asking President Eisenhower to wash dishes. I said, you can't bring yourself down to wrestling. I just felt that he had been the tops in America. Why should he wrestle?
The Inland Revenue Service pursued Louis for over 10 years. They finally threw in the towel in 1962, although on paper, Louis remained in debt to the government for the rest of his life.
I just turned 22 years old. I must be the greatest. I shook up the world. I shook up the world. I shook up the world.
When Muhammad Ali won the heavyweight title in 1964, it marked the beginning of a new era in American sport. Lewis's brand of public relations was a thing of the past.
Ali was very stylistically different. He brought a sort of flamboyance, a flash, a kind of bravado, a braggadocio to the boxing ring, a sort of in-your-face quality that Joe Louis didn't have that I think very much appealed to the times.
No single incident better illustrated just how much the times had changed than when Muhammad Ali refused to join the army and go to Vietnam. To Lewis, this was inconceivable.
How do you feel about Cassius Clay's refusal to be drafted?
Yeah, we're not here about Cassius Clay. I feel by any American who don't want to fight for his country. I think it's very bad.
There were still many black Americans who were very much in the same place that they were in the 1940s and 1950s, who saw military service as something that was important, expected, and essential. But many, many more, both white and black, who saw Joe Louis and those who sort of carried on Joe Louis's legacy as being out of place and out of time.
The flashpoint finally came when Muhammad Ali flatly accused Lewis of kowtowing to whites, using the bitterest of insults.
Joe Louis make himself look real ignorant when he attacks me for standing for my people, and he looks ignorant when he attacks these young, educated Olympic boys who are standing up for freedom of their people. Joe Louis is making himself a Uncle Tom for white people. Negroes don't follow and idolize this part of Joe Louis. If it's your opposition, it's our...
Joe did a heck of a job in terms of paving a road that enabled us to get to the struggles that we had to fight. My generation, which was the same generation of Muhammad Ali, and when a heavyweight champion and beneficiary of Joe Louis's struggles called him an Uncle Tom, it hurt him deeply. But Ali wanted full dignity and respect as a man, along with access as an athlete, something that Joe Louis could only hope for and aspire to.
Cast aside by the new generation, Louis settled for the easy celebrity of life in Las Vegas. He had married for a third time and had a regular job as a casino host at Caesar's Palace. But old friends had noticed a change.
One time he called me up and asked me to come down to the hotel. And I went down and he was in their little living room sitting down with a glass of whiskey, glass this tall with about this much whiskey in it, brandy. I said, Joe, what is this? He said, oh yeah. He started drinking. And Joe would never, you can see him in this picture I showed you, where that I'm drinking champagne and he's eating an apple on my wedding day. He wouldn't even drink champagne. And I was so surprised to see him drinking.
As it turned out, these were only the symptoms of more serious problems.
Joe's physician called me to tell me that Joe was on cocaine, but that there had been a insanity in Joe's family, and he felt that the cocaine would accelerate a condition which was inherited. Joe denied it, of course. But he came here, and he said people were, gangsters were trying to get him. He could hear the voices coming out of the air conditioning unit. Then we knew that he was seriously ill.
I think one of the most difficult things that I did was signing the papers to have my father committed to psychological observation in Denver, Colorado, back in the 60s. I didn't think I would ever see my father again. I didn't think I'd ever have a relationship with my father again because he was so hurt by the fact that I had not discussed it with him But had I done so, he would have walked out the door and gotten an airplane and left.
But the hospital couldn't keep him indefinitely. As soon as he was well enough, Lewis picked up where he had left off.
Joe Lewis ended his days as a greeter at Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas. And I know there's a popular feeling about how he was abused. I had an argument with a guy about this. The guy's an Afro-American, and he said, how can you say he was happy? Now you're perpetuating the stereotype. Happy guy, give him money, let him gamble, let him dance, let him sing, whatever. Well, that might be so, but Joe Lewis lost his mind, which is no secret. And at that point, his mind was gone. And in the end, Lewis was happiest when he could gamble. He liked the milieu in Las Vegas. And as long as he didn't have to think about those people who were out to get him and whatever, and he lost himself in this, he was happy. So in that sense, he ended his days not continually tormented.
There were tributes and even reconciliations. Old conflicts outside as well as inside the ring were forgotten. And when his health began to fail, wealthy friends were there to support him.
About 3,000 people, including many celebrities, gathered at Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas for an emotional service in memory of the former heavyweight boxing champion Joe Lewis, who died of a heart attack last Sunday. Among those who assembled to hear the tributes to the legendary Brown Bomber was another former champion, Muhammad Ali.
We really do not assess the true measure and magnitude of a life until we see the size of the hole that's left upon the death of that person. And I think that even with Joe's decline and all of his problems, the size of the hole in the fabric of American society was so large and so immense that it swallowed up, it consumed any nuance that somehow reflected negatively upon the man, his life, and his contribution.
I think that Joe Lewis showed black people that they could be somebody, not necessarily a boxer, but that they could succeed at the highest levels, perhaps, of whatever they took on. I think that he is a success model for black people.
My definition of a hero is simply, do you change the people's attitudes? Have you changed society? Have you forced people to deal with their conscience? Have you forced people to deal with their inner souls about certain subjects that otherwise they wouldn't touch? And Joe Lewis forced Americans to deal with that. He changed attitudes, and those changes were significant, and they were continuous, and they were deep.
Got a head built for a crown. Solid, mellow, round, good fellow. That's George the Bomber. Who's the credit to his race? Aids the trunks with a poker face. Joy for Lloyd, no jive to McCoy. That's Joe the Bomber. Now set a pace in his race to make history. Can he swing in a ring? Jackie's murder of the first degree. Let's join in and shout hooray. Send that new champ on its way. Solid, mellow, all-round good fellow. That's Joe the Bomber.